Betty, you look pretty.
Not you, Betty. Oh, you look good. Governor?
Hello, Bert.
I want to tell you something. About 2 weeks ago when I was here and we had a little, picking and singing.
Yes.
I went back to California and I told the producers of my little show, I call it little, but you're biggies. I said, I want to do a show from the governor's house with picking and singing. They said, he snapped. He's finally snapped. A show from the governor's mansion. Eat your heart out, Ronald Reagan, wherever you are. We're here. And I can't think of two nicer people in the world to host a party.
I can't either. Oh, okay.
I understand that you have get-togethers like this all the time.
Well, Bert, we have them occasionally. Of course, you know, a governor has to run the government. And I look after those things a great deal of the time. But I'm pleased to tell you that there are those great moments when we can get together and sing and visit and just be people together, and it's an awfully good feeling.
Let me ask you something, Governor. Is there any advantages or disadvantages to having Minnie Pearl as your next-door neighbor?
Come on, Nat. Come on.
Bert, you do want the truth. I know you
Oh, no,
I
want the no, truth. No, no, no.
I want the truth. Think of this as the Oral Roberts Show.
All right. Well, Bert, let me say, perhaps one of the great disadvantages to living next to Minnie Pearl is that when I'm not with her, I want to be.
Oh, well, that's nice.
Well, one of the great advantages is that when I'm with her, or when I think about her, I'm happy.
Now, isn't that nice?
That's amazing.
That's the truth.
I like it. That's me, son. Minnie?
Yes, sir.
You know something that I never realized is that
I was so beautiful.
No, without that hat, you are terribly sexy. I was looking at your getaways a little while ago. Super getaways. I'd say on a 10 scale, about a 9.
But the legs are the last to go, Bert. But you are very kind.
So legs like that last time had a message tied to them. I just threw that in.
I know you did.
You'll never get another job from me. No, he got his first job from me. You'll never get another one.
Jim, don't you think Minnie talks funny?
She does have kind of an accent.
Tell me about your hometown.
Oh, yes, my hometown, Grinder Switch.
Grinder Switch.
What you said about that place was so small, only half.
Oh, you can tell when there's a funeral there. The front tractor's got its lights on.
What was it the Giesenslaw brothers say about that town of Snook, Texas?
Snook.
It's a mile this side of resume speed.
They show the $100 movie at 7 o'clock.
This is the wildest crew I've ever got to meet.
It's a strange group.
It's a strange group.
Do you remember the first song that you sang on the Grand Ole Opry?
Oh, I've been trying to forget it for years. Yes, I do indeed.
It's a beautiful song.
It tells a story.
Would you do it?
I'd love to. If
you
play
the
piano.
What, piano's right over here.
Oh, good.
Next to Charlie Rich.
Yeah.
My gosh.
Bobby Goldberg, Charlie Rich. This piano will never be the same. I'm sorry about this, Charlie, but it won't be the same. Near a quiet country village stood a maple on the hill. There I sat with my Geneva long ago. Oh, isn't that great? There the moon was shining brightly. We could hear the whippoorwill as we sat beneath the maple on the hill. How about that?
Hang on, Chief. I bet you've got a report.
This is where I read to death.
Now, how did you take up what some people would consider to be a negative and make it a positive?
Oh. Are you talking about my speech or my marriage?
No, you... I don't like to be set up like that on my own show. No, I'm talking about your body. Oh, so you're stuttering.
Well, Bert, actually, I stuttered, you know, all my life, far back as I can remember. And I'm not using this as a, I feel that I can have a talent other than my stutter. And as a matter of fact, I was a pretty successful songwriter before I ever performed, actually, where I got to talk, you know. I worked with Minnie before, when I first came to Nashville, but I didn't get to talk.
Did you introduce Minnie's show?
No.
He was a fabulous writer.
I
was kidding.
I wouldn't say anything, would I?
I heard that you were a great
writer. I wouldn't say a thing. And then,
And I tried to get you to.
That's right. And, as I met entertainers, you know, I'd meet people, Porter and Jimmy Dean and Roger. I'd meet the people and they'd say, man, get out there and talk. be yourself. Yeah. And finally I did. I started, you know, and then things began to happen. And I found out that the whole world was my friend instead of against me. And it's been good, and I have learned to live a happy life.
Well, everybody's got a Grandpa Jones story.
Right.
But everybody.
I want everybody to have
everybody has a Mel Tillis story. No. Man, have you got a Mel Tillis story?
Well, he was telling me one that I wanted him to tell about where he went to the speech school where you had to.
They sent you on field trips.
Yeah.
When you stutter, that's why that's why he doesn't stutter when he sings, because it's a rhythm going. I want to be with love. Now, Deacon, that's why he does his hand like this, because it's to a rhythm.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
it's a mechanical.
If he does this, I will not be here tomorrow. He can talk it, right? Now, show him what I mean.
It is.
I will be.
Well, I'm trying to get started. This was at the University of Tampa, and they had this speech school, and I went out on what they call a field trip, and it builds up your courage. You're supposed to ask someone how to get to the bus station. On my first field trip, I was already embarrassed because the teacher that I had was about 23 years old, and real abusive, and it embarrassed me to talk in front of her, you know, because I liked her a lot. We went out on this field trip, and she said, now here comes a man, and he come along. He wasn't expecting a thing. And I'm supposed to ask him, how do I get to the bus station? Well, here he comes. And here he comes. I said, and he went on about me. He was all the way into the corner. Guess she looked at me, she said, Mel, try again.
Mel, tell him about the time
And I started to beat on my leg. Can you tell me how to get to the Trailway bus station? I never did get to my leg.
Now, was that you told about that time you was in the army and they wouldn't let you be a sergeant because before you could say halt, they'd all walk up the trunk.
I could march them in cadence, you know, with them all talking. I mean, one, two, three, four. And I felt a sense of power. Here I had 80 boys from Pennsylvania.
Where were they heading? Into the wall?
No, and I could march them, but I had a hard time stopping.
Will you do a song now?
Yes, if I may. This song is about a lonely man. And it's,
turn off Roger's
it's called
microphone.
Midnight and Me in the Blue.
What's it called?
Me in the Blue.
Midnight.
And the Blue.
No.
Midnight, Me in the Blue.
Midnight, Me and the Blue. New song.
Long train rumbles low. In the distance, hear it blow. Dawn engineers know I miss you. And they're reminding me how lonely nights can be when it's midnight. Cars going down the street, no traffic jams to me. This time of night they'll drive right through. And they all go right by. They don't know I cry when it's midnight. Me and the blue. Time in the world. Me, I'm the loneliest guy with no girl. My world began when it ended with you. And it's mid.
Second one.
Mid with you. Okay, hold on, I got it. Wait a minute. I have a 35-piece orchestra accompanying me.
When it's midnight, me and the blue.
Songs that you've written, like Ruby Don't Take Your Love to Town.
Detroit City.
Yeah.
Well, you can imagine how great he had to be because he could never hype nobody on.
The songs had to stand for themselves.
Yeah. Honestly, he brought me some songs the first time, and he didn't say nothing. He brought the tape in. I played his songs. I said, man, isn't this fantastic? That's true.
Yeah. Back in the kitchen and I want you to hear him say. You've been helping out with all this and that's real well. I want you to hear him say, okay?
Somebody back in the kitchen?
Mm-hmm.
This is the governor's daughter,
by
the way.
And
this is Julie.
Julie Dunn. She's beautiful.
Somebody in the kitchen you want me to hear? Uh-huh. Well, I don't know. We got a kind of a full program. Is he talented?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, bring him on.
Okay.
You never know.
It's your house, Governor.
Thank you, Bert. I appreciate that.
You didn't think for 1 minute. Where's my microphone?
You can have that one.
You didn't think for 1 minute you could have a program from my hometown without the Dixie Flyer. The Winchester Flyer.
Dixie Flyer.
The Dixie Flyer. They all know, we all know what the Dixie Flyer is, don't we?
Sure.
Okay, they got you out of the kitchen.
Got me out of the kitchen.
All right, you're going to have to sing, and
I'm
gonna
have
that's
to sing.
It.
Okay.
Can you help her? Somebody can
I
help
have
her?
A little Nashville song.
Okay.
I'd like to dedicate to you.
To me?
It's a Nashville song.
Okay.
Bobby?
You know...
Sit down, isn't that good?
Okay. Howdy.
Oh, good.
Howdy, darling. Hi, Jim. Such right. A good party. Hi, Mel. I'll just keep on falling in love till I get it right. Right now I'm like a wounded bird, hungry for the sky. But if I try my wings and try long enough, I'm bound to learn to fly. I'll just keep on falling in love till I get it right. My door to love has opened out more times than in. I'm either fool or wise enough to open it again. For I'll never know what's beyond the mountain till I reach that outside. I'll just keep on falling in love till I get it right. Now if practice makes perfect, then I'm near about as perfect.
Don't get dirty.
As I'll ever be in my life. I just keep on falling in love till I get it right. Then I'll get it right. I'll get it right.
The girl in the kitchen.